You know, Kashmir defeated Mahmud Ghazni twice. The same Mahmud Ghazni who did not find much resistance, as our history tells us, when he roamed our land up and down, went several times to Somnath. He could not enter Kashmir. He tried twice. Islam did not come to Kashmir riding on a horse carrying a sword. No. The first Muslim Sultan of Kashmir, called Shah Mir, who ascended the throne on 1339, had come in 1315 to Kashmir as a refugee. Refugees, I'm sure you understand. He came as a refugee, he was given refuge. He had come from neighboring Swat Valley. Swat, I'm sure most of you understood, where Malala Yousafzai came from, who was shot in the head for daring to pursue her studies in a school. From that Swat, he came because he was fleeing for his life. He had tried to stage a coup. He was an ambitious young man, maybe in his early 20s. And the king of Kashmir, Sahadev, gave him refuge, thinking that Islam has come so close and he's from the noble family, he'll be grateful for this refuge and he will also help us prepare better for the enemy who is knocking at the door. Little did he know that this refugee, far from being grateful, would turn out to be so crafty that he would manipulate the nobility, cause intrigues, and then maneuver his way to the throne. Kashmir was besieged by a Tatar invader who managed to come in and followed a scorched earth policy, destroyed all farms, reduced Kashmir to famine, and then when he left with hordes of men as slaves, but couldn't cross the valley. He perished along with his slaves under an avalanche. But while all this instability was there and king was moved to some kind of safe zone, he first murdered the Prime Minister, who was Ramchandra, at the pretext of going to see him, and then ascended the throne, forced his daughter into marriage, Kota Rani. Eventually, Kota Rani also was murdered, and he, through consensus, you know, political rivalries, and we must draw these lessons. Political rivals do not let each other take the high place and then choose the so-called weakest amongst them, who is convenient to all and least threatening because he is an outsider and doesn't have roots in the place. Through this kind of palace intrigue, he ascended the throne. And he ascended the throne with a Raj Tilak, with a Mantrochar, with all the Hindu rituals that were prevalent in that time. His next six successors would take Raj Tilak, would ascend the throne in those very Sanatani rituals. And Sanskrit remained the court language for next more than 100 years. From 1339, we have evidence till beyond 1450, Sanskrit was the court language. But as they knew that they were outsiders and they didn't have enough depth, enough root in the kingdom, they started importing missionaries in order to convert. And when conversion didn't come easy, they became brutal. The fourth successor to Shah Mir was Sikandar Butshikan, who earned the sobriquet of an iconoclast because he started to destroy temples. By 1372, one of the missionaries, Shah Hamdan, came and he saw these sultans, you know, wearing a tilak, wearing a Hindu safa and conducting the affairs in Sanskrit. He scoffed at them and he laid down conditions as to how Hindu subjects, non-Muslim subjects of the state of Jammu and Kashmir should be dealt with. Among the several conditions, and some of them are funny, for example, one condition is that a Hindu could not wear a ring with a diamond studded in it. You know, the idea was you could not flaunt your wealth, even if you were wealthy. By law, you were prohibited. You could not wear embroidered clothes. You had to wear plain clothes. You could not pass yourself off as a Muslim if you were not a Muslim, because Muslims had all these privileges. You could not wear, you could not ride a harnessed horse. First, you could not ride a horse. And if for some reason you had to be given permission, then it wouldn't be a harnessed horse. You couldn't move about from your house bearing arms, which tells me that my ancestors bore arms. That was a tradition. You wouldn't be allowed to persuade even your closest kin and kith if that person wished to convert to Islam, even if it was your daughter, your brother, your son. You could not even as much as persuade, because that would be considered creating obstacles to somebody's conversion. You could not mourn your dead by crying over the body. About 24 of such conditions, it literally disarmed us, it humiliated us. The more stringent ones were, you could not build temples. You could not repair old temples. So in our own land, in our own place where we lived for generations and practiced our faith, such were the restrictions placed. Some of the converted amongst us did help them, but I think it was our foolishness. We marvel at our inclusivity, quote unquote. We marvel at, you know, we have great deal, we prance about saying we are liberal. We have a concept. I think it's, to flaunt such a concept is wonderful, but if you are unmindful of the world in which you live, it sometimes is foolish. When your Catholicity, when your openness, when your liberalism is up against the most illiberal, unfree, intolerant mindset, your liberalism is poison for you. You can't practice it with illiberals. You can't practice your tolerance with intolerant. You have to be intolerant of intolerance if you want to preserve tolerance. So in Sanskrit they say Shatrubodh. We didn't know how to identify the enemies from among the people who pretended to be friends. We did not have Sankat Bodh. We didn't know how to see trouble when it hadn't hit us. So we were swamped. 480 years of incessant Islamic rule from 1339 to 1819, reduced us from near 100% demography to barely double digits in 1819 when we were delivered from our genocide by Maharaja Ranjit Singh. Mughals came, Pathans came, Chaks came, these sultans of Shamsuddin dynasty. They plundered us, they mercilessly converted us, they drove us out. I don't know who else to blame but our own foolishness and our inability to learn from those experiences. Thank you, Monica ji.
So Shilji, I hear you talk about enemies and Shatruvos. Who were the enemies, internal or external?
I think both. We suffered from lack of unity. Even today, we suffer from lack of unity, a lack of unified purpose.